Last time we left Lafayette, he was spending some time in well-earned rest overseas because he was trying to escape a revolution. Follow the tutorial below, link below for the further parts of that. If you are interested in getting started with trying to help Lafayette do something while he's overseas, you've come to the right place. We are going to do some events in this tutorial. The first we're going to do is a non-interrupting event, which means we would like to do this task here, which is serve time overseas, but we also want to do something else periodically in parallel without interrupting it. So let's head back to the model. And to do this, we're actually going to take an event here, a boundary event specifically. Now, events can be all over the place. They can be intermediate events. They can be start events, end events. This boundary event means that the scope of it is limited to while this task is activated. I will also change it to a non-interrupting timer boundary event. Very long thing that basically means that this thing here is an event that will not interrupt the task, but and it's a timer, so it'll mean that it's dealing with time and will go off after a certain amount of time. Once it does go off, we will have a try to escape back to France. So we're spending our time overseas and having fun, but also we kind of want to get back to France at some stage. Lafayette's from there. He likes it. He's got friends there. So he might want to check that out. So this means that occasionally we want to do this. Now, we also don't want to do it just once, right? Because you can't just try once and give up. We want a little more grit and determination from our Lafayette. So we're actually going to do this frequently. Which means we're actually going to have a cycle. So it means it's going to keep on doing something until a certain amount of time. So let me explain how that works. We're going to open the properties panel up, select the timer event, and you'll see here there are three options: date, duration, and cycle. If I was going to wait for a specific date in the future, then I would use that, but we don't want that at all because we don't know what time it'll be by the time we get here. If we wanted to wait for a certain amount of time and then immediately go, we kind of do want that, but this would be one-off duration. The other one is that if we have a cycle time, this is if we want to do this recurringly. So we want to do it in a cycle, which we do. So cycle time selected. Now, the annotation we use here is called ISO 8601, which is a duration, which is a method for creating durations. So let me just add that now. The durations are going to start with the letter R, which stands for repeat. Now, I could do a few different things here. If I do R5, that means it'll repeat 5 times. But we actually wanted to go for as long as this task is active, which means we just say R, repeat forever as long as this task, as long as we're in scope. And then we have the time period, which is period time, let's say 3 seconds. We can do all sorts of different permutations, but that works for us. So now I'm going to save that, and I'm now going to redeploy it. And then we're going to see how this works in runtime. As you've done before, deploying just involves a REST call, specifically right up here. If I click on that, it'll point me to the location where I'm currently running the engine, and it'll give the two forms I've created, and it'll take the change model and head it up. We've already done this once before, so if we do it this time, while I suspect we have a deployment successful, which means heading back to cockpit means that this too, if I refresh, will end up going to one higher, which, spoilers, is 3. So 3 will be the one we want, and there we have our new version. So now I'm just going to step through it. Before I step through it, I'm going to do an additional fun little thing with this, which is I'm going to show off the Swagger API. So one of the unique things about Camunda Run is that you can actually access the API directly using Swagger UI, and is already on board with Camunda Run's distribution. So if I go to localhost 8080/SwaggerUI, what I get is a user interface that allows you to make REST calls directly to the engine. This is really handy if you want to do anything around learning how the API works, understanding how to make the calls directly. So in this case, instead of starting it like I have in past by going to task list and clicking start, I'm actually going to go down and find the right REST call. So I'm going to go down to process definition, which is here. Great. If I click on that, and there's one that should say start. There we go, there's start. So let's click on that. So the REST call is sending the engine process definition key, then with the key start. Okay, so far so good. So what we need then, you can see here that we have the key of the process in this case is right here, help Lafayette escape. So I'm gonna copy that and place it right here. We then have some variables we can add. You can see here, this shows an example of the request body you're supposed to send. This is all fine. We actually don't need any of that. We can remove it actually, because we don't need any variables to start the process with. So I'm just going to select all of that and just get rid of it. And just hit an empty JSON variable. So what will happen is I'm going to send this, click execute. Great, we got a 200 back. We have, you can see in the response, it tells you this is the ID of the process that got started. It's not ended yet, so it's not a single three-through process. And actually, if I go to cockpit now, I suspect I will see a token if I refresh right here in prepare for departure. Marvelous, we do indeed. Now we still need to go to task list in order to complete the task and move forward. So let's do that now. So in task list, I'm going to, we have a prepare for departure. Mark book to pack. This time I think I will go with Super Stud by Paul Feig. And we are going to, how can we help? Who are you gonna ask for help? Let's go with Austria again, because I do have my worker running in the background. So they should complete the task and then move the process forward quite quickly. So let's do it. Great. Spend time overseas. We are right here, exactly where we suspect. So we, while waiting for this task to occur, a timer has started, okay? And what I expect is after a couple of seconds, we will actually end up triggering that. And in from cockpit's perspective, if I refresh this page, the token will have moved forward to, oh look, wow, that was a lot of seconds that I've been speaking for. So you can see that already we've launched four of them, very good. And if I refresh that, I suspect every now and then we'll get a couple more, six now, that's pretty good. How are we getting on? Ooh, seven, so that's actually speeding up quite a bit. We can also, if we want, I can, if this, this is a really cool feature, this creates a job in the engine, this timer, and this is getting a little bit extreme, and we actually have 10 now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to see here that we have this job ID and the activity is frequently, which of course is the name of the task. I can actually pause this job and the process actually stays the same. So the process actually isn't affected. So this is now at 14. So let's pause it. And now it's suspended. So that means that this timer will no longer fire. This is a really cool feature for as an admin to be able to mess around with the runtime of the engine if something untoward is happening. So then we'll be on 14 for quite some time until we unpause it, and we can even schedule an unpause. Okay, so this is a good place to be in for Lafayette. He's got a lot of escaping to do, probably too much, I would say. Luckily I've paused it for now, but let's try and expand this to be a little more realistic. Right now we have here send request for help. What if they don't help? This is a very important thing. I mean, he is asking people for help and maybe it won't happen. What I'm gonna do is I'm going to change my worker. I'm going to make it so that from here on in, it's going to be able to assess the request and actually in some cases send back an error. And that error is going to be caught here and we're going to change the course of the process. So that is the next symbol we're going to build. We're going to build a BPMN error. And for this, we're actually going to start with the modeler, because we need to actually model catching the error before we model throwing it. We can do either or, but this is the one I've decided on going for. So for that, again, it's a boundary event, but it's an interrupting one. I will drag and drop it here. And you can see that I'm going to change this to an error. Great. So an error happens, well, there's like two types of errors. There are incidents, which are technical errors, which means some sort of technical thing has failed. And there's these, which are BPMN errors. The goal of these is actually not to catch technical errors, but rather to catch what we call business errors. Things that we predict will happen in the process that aren't the ideal scenario, but we can deal with them without actually raising a technical error, one that like an admin or a programmer needs to worry about. So in this case, we are going to deal with an error. And that error is going to be called refuse help. So refuse help is the code. This is the key by which the correlation between throw and catch happens. So you'll see later on when I throw the error in the code, I'll be using the same code. So this is what I'm waiting to catch. Then we'll go up here and this is going to be refused, help refused. Okay, and if a help is refused, it's very, very sad, we'll go up here. And I mean, Lafayette's gonna, he's not gonna have a good time of it. So Laf is gonna die. Laf dies, it's very sad, he needs this help. So this is what's gonna happen. The only thing we need to do from a BPMN perspective is just this. We've added the error boundary event, that is now done. We can now continue the fun. So let's deploy this new version. Great. And now the latest version of the process, if we go back to the process itself, is, as we suspected, Laf dies. So now it's going to be our role to change the worker, because you may remember that this section here is run by this automated worker, which, as you see, ran earlier to complete the Superstud by Paul Feig. Very good book. And this particular worker right now just takes send letter and it posts a little reminder and then sends back a can't help, which is unfortunate, which isn't accurate because then it assumes help happens. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to change this code a bit. I'm going to change specifically this part. Actually, let's just, I'm going to take the code from the repo, which is linked below. You can do the same and I'll just talk through it. So a lot of it hasn't changed. Book. We get the book back. We print a reminder. We then say, we create a variable called that Austria can't help. The important thing is this if statement here. So Austria are aware that they are, let's say, the potential to stroke their ego is exists, and therefore if they've included a book and the word Austria is in the title, that is a good sign. The task will complete successfully. If not, unfortunately, we have a new method here where we're going to actually handle a BPMN error. We send back the task object, we send back refuse help, which you may remember is the correlation key, and we're going to send back a message that says, sorry, you're on your own, as well as the process variables. And this will then trigger the error event. Now, the nice thing is that I just need to save this, kill the worker currently, and then as we did before, node start the worker, and it's now subscribed. And that's it. We now have a new feature. If we go back to cockpit, so we see this has already been deployed. So we go back to cockpit. We can then start this process. Once more, I will start it from, I will start this one from task list. We are then going to, oh, it's a lot of trying to escape. We're then going to go up here and we're going to try and trigger this error. So I'm going to book to pack. I'm going to go with, what's a good book to go with? I, Claudius. By Robert Graves. Okay, and who can we help? Let's go with Austria can help. Marvelous. Unfortunately, Hi Claudius is not a a book that does not reference Austria in any way. So you can tell right now we've immediately had our help refused and now we've gone up to Laf dies. So now we have a method of being able to have an external service trigger an error. And actually, if we take a look at the message, we can actually see handled handled BPMN error for this task and it's gone back to waiting. So that's hopefully a good example of events in a nutshell. We have once again helped Lafayette in sort of a couple of different ways. I hope this helps you understand Camunda Run and helps you understand a little bit about a man who is very well known for multiple revolutions. Talk to you next time. Goodbye.